If you are expert in design world, get into sales, get into customer support, get into functions which interact with customers. So you start to understand how the customer thinks, how the customer behaves. So it's a 3, 4, 5 years of apprenticeship, self induced apprenticeship. There's no rush to get out unless you are approaching 40 and you start to feel the pressure of middle age, that hey, I need to better do something before I have to become practical, because my kids are going to be now teenagers pretty soon, they need to go to college. The family pressures take over. So, but there's the age of 27 to 36, 37, 10 years, we are young enough and foolish enough to try new stuff, but you are seasoned enough not to do real foolish stuff, right? Because you're 22 years old, you don't even know how the world works, and so there's 4 or 5 years of training at somebody else's little, right? All right.
Thank you.
So I had a question. Did you have a mentor, first of all, like a couple of questions I had?
Did I have what?
A mentor?
No. That was the tough part. See, the reason we started Thai was, there were 20 of us who had done well in the 80s. And when we started to meet each other, we discovered that we all had a very lonely journey. Very lonely journey with no mentors, no believers in us. As a matter of fact, the people will say, what's the matter with you? You're so good at what you do. Why are you trying to do something that you're not good at? So there was a strong discouragement by everybody to us. So we had no mentors. As a matter of fact, if you got in trouble and you needed some help, the first thing people will tell you, didn't I tell you? Didn't I tell you that you're not cut out for this kind of work? So we had to set it up and do it ourselves, dig deeper. The whole basis of Thai was, we said it shouldn't have been that lonely for us, and it shouldn't be that lonely going forward for people. And we will become the mentors. We will become the people who encourage and inspire you. And that was the basis of Thai.
So how did you find the right team to work on? Like, suppose if you have an idea and you don't have the sufficient skills, but you have an idea. So how do you go about
here's how you do it. You as an entrepreneur have to be a salesperson above everything else. First, you have to sell yourself to give up your job to pursue your dream, right? Then you have to sell to your parents to let you do it. Maybe you have to sell to your spouse. Then you have to sell to potential partners, employees to come and work with you long before you are able to pay them market salaries and market wages. Right? Then you have to sell to the potential investors to give you some money, bet on you. Then you have to sell to customers long before you have products. So you are always selling. So your job is to make sure that you are inspiring people to come and work with you. It's going to be great when it works. So that's what the entrepreneurs do. They assemble the teams, they assemble the resources, but they have to infect others with their excitement, their enthusiasm, right? You have to charm people out of their money and all that. Entrepreneurs are by natural salespeople.
So I'm talking more in terms like kind of like the idea is very unique and being getting like.
So that's the unique idea that you have. You have to excite the other people about that idea. Hey, if we made this happen, it'll be a very big deal. When the networking then started to excite me, I went and talked to my friends that I I should date along with me. I had to tell them, hey, if we do this thing, we will be on the top of the world. I had to excite them. And they have to have faith in you. So the ideas by themselves are a dime a dozen. It's idea in the hand of an entrepreneur who's able to make it happen, right? Who's able to assemble resources, assemble teams, right?
I was asking more of kind of like if the idea is being stolen from you, and then some of your team members just go say that it's not the idea is not going to work, and then start something of their own, and
the ideas by themselves are never have any value. If somebody can steal your idea and make it happen, then you don't have much anyway. You're not an Einstein. Ideas by themselves have no value. Ideas in your hand, with your excitement, with your salesmanship, with your is the whole thing, right? If somebody can hear your story and also do it, then you have nothing anyway. Because once you start doing it, they will know what you're doing anyway. And they will fast follow you. Microsoft will put 20 engineers on it and copy your stuff overnight. Ideas have no value by themselves. If you think you have an idea, you know, you're foolish, because there are people as smart or smarter than you out there looking at the same problem, and they will have the same idea with a slightly better, you know, perspective. So every idea that you think you have is unique. You know, you should assume there are at least 10 people out there, you know, with the same idea. Your job is to out-hustle them, out-execute them, and get there before they do at the end line. If you're worried about people stealing your idea, you're not turned out to be an entrepreneur. People have to steal your brain, people have to steal your level of energy, people have to steal your level of excitement. Okay.
So a lot of businesses that we see in India are based on ideas which have worked in US and then they're executing it in India in a different way. Knowing the businesses in India, because you yourself run a venture fund, what do you see are the key areas where good businesses can be built in India and very innovative ideas where there is a real need gap?
Well, sir, if you are doing the same thing which has been done in the US and a day late, it's hard for me to imagine you can build a large business out of it. You know, because US entrepreneurs are as sharp as you. They can come and set up a shop in India and hire people So you don't bring much to the, when you copy somebody else's idea, you don't bring much to the party. In China, it's different. China is insular culturally, has a language issues. You know, so it's very hard for US entrepreneurs to establish themselves in China. So Chinese entrepreneurs can copy a Google model or US models and localize. Indian entrepreneurs don't have that luxury, right? So you have to look at what you bring to the party as Indian entrepreneurs. Look at what happened with IT industry. IT industry said, hey, we got a cheap labor, we got a lack of capital, we don't have much capital. There's a need out there that items handle using the cheap Indian labor and sort of charge US type of prices with Indian type of trust. So they assembled very quickly the teams in India to tackle the problems. So they were doing what an entrepreneur does. You know, the service business, like I told somebody, doesn't take much capital. It can become cash flow positive very quickly. So they built very large companies as a result of that one. Infosys, Wipro, TCS, go down the list. Because they were using the raw material in India and training them to solve the complex US problems, right? And they were able to outprice, outmuscle, large established players in the US. And so that thing has played out. That the wage arbitrage part has played out. There's a domestic market which does not want to pay the US type of prices. I hear about frugal innovation, that Indians are getting good at. There's Indian Jadar. You need to do something, which gives you some natural advantage in the environment that you are, right? But I've seen entrepreneurs out of Chennai doing world-class products. What is that SaaS company out of Chennai doing? Distance is not a disadvantage anymore. Internet has leveled the world. We all heard that the flat world theory. You can sell on internet and nobody knows that you're based in Chennai. Right? You can have the offering. So I think you have as much of a position anywhere in the world. You need to identify the needs that customers have, which have been not been met by established players and try to serve those needs better than anybody else, before anybody else.
Hello, sir. So, there's always an entrepreneur's paradox in India, because in India, what happens, most of the things doesn't go according to the plan. Let it be your birth or let it be your career, whatever. So, the whole thing is here, shall I take up a venture which is more profitable or in a field which I have worked, or shall I take up an entrepreneurship venture which is my passion? So how do you relate passion and entrepreneurship?
I don't see the conflict. Without passion, you won't be able to sustain your entrepreneurship. Right? You have to have this abiding faith in your own capabilities and passion to show the world you can execute, you can deliver. So I don't see a problem. Now this issue of entrepreneur, if things don't grow according to the plan, that is true in almost every venture. Almost every venture. You imagine a problem, you see a thing there, and then you start to engage with the marketplace, and then you discover customer has moved on, market has moved on, technology is changing. So there is this constant reinventing. So I have never met an entrepreneur who went from start to finish with the exact same plan that he had in the beginning. The market has a way of forcing you to react to itself. There's a new competition emerging, there's a new platform announced, there's a new technical breakthrough. So all these are the things that force you to react and adapt. Entrepreneurs are very adaptable people. They are always adapting to the new reality. And that's the beauty of the entrepreneurship. That's the beauty of the entrepreneurship. You don't run into walls. You don't run into dead ends. You're always keeping your eyes and ears open here and see what. See, one of the things entrepreneurs do is to make sure that that they are giving themselves new options. I am going down this path, and I say, what is my plan B, and what is my plan C, and what is my plan D, if I run into problem here? So you are always, thinking through the issues long before they emerge, so you are prepared. Okay.
So, my question is a bit naive, but still, is there any process as such to generate an idea? Means any specific steps, like it has been heard that you must be passionate and all those subjective things come into play, but still means is there any algorithm or specific steps or process that which we can indulge in to be more specific towards that?
I don't know if there's, for ideation, I don't know if there's a process or algorithms. I don't even know if they're possible. The ideas come to you looking at where the world is. There's aha moment. And you need to anticipate. You can see how the forces are aligned, how the world is changing, how the internet is happening, this is happening. And you can think through and say, if things come to pass, this will have to happen. 2 years out, 3 years out, 4 years out. Entrepreneurs have to look down the road. You cannot be solving today's problems or yesterday's problems. Because by the time you solve them, the world has moved on.